Greetings, friends and brethren. This is Dr. Bob Teal for the Continuing Church of God. Today I'd like to talk about the Old Testament canon. Who knew? What do you mean, who knew? Who knew what it was? Who knew when it was? Did somebody change it? Who's actually contending for the faith once for all delivered to the saints? Well, in order to answer all those questions, I'm going to go through scriptures, both in the Old and New Testament, as well as some Church of God writings, a lot of Jewish writings, and some Catholic and Eastern Orthodox reports or writings to kind of answer those questions. Now, why is this important? Well, if you've got your Bibles, you might want to follow along. I'm going to start with something that Jesus said. This is in John 17, verse 17. It's only a short passage. You don't have to go there, but if you don't want to. But let me just go ahead and read this to you. Jesus prayed, John 17, 17. Sanctify them, that's God's people, the Christians, by your truth. Your word is truth. Well, the word it's talking about is the Bible. You know, sometimes Christians are called the people of the book. Well, that book is the Bible. But what makes that book up? Well, you say, well, I've got one, and whatever books are in my copy. If you are Eastern Orthodox or Roman Catholic, you may have some additional books in terms of the Old Testament. And there are other religions that have other books as well. But as far as from a Christian perspective, you know, what books are in the Bible, the Hebrew Bibles is called, or the Old Testament, and who preserved it, and is there any information that can help us answer those questions? Because we're supposed to be sanctified or set apart by the truth, and God's word is truth. We really need to know which words are God's words and which words aren't. I'm going to go to Romans chapter 3, starting in verse 1. This is something the Apostle Paul wrote. And he said, what advantage has then the Jew? Or what profit is circumcision? Much in every way. Okay, so there's some benefit. So the Jews had a particular advantage over other peoples for some reason. Why? Chiefly, there's the main reason. Because to them were committed the oracles of God. Now the Greek term for oracle means inspired writings. Based on historical records, this was so because it was the Jews in Palestine who preserved what's called the Old Testament. Now, Jesus, of course, grew up in Palestine, otherwise called Israel, but Palestine, that general area there. And it's thus reasonable to conclude he used the same books as the Old Testament that were preserved by the Jews in Palestine. Now, I'd like to go to the Old Testament. I'd like to read something from Daniel, Daniel chapter 9, starting in verse 1. Now it says, in the first year of Darius, son of Ahasuerus, of the lineage of the Medes, who was made king over the realm of the Chaldeans, so this is a time frame, in the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, understood by the books the number of years specified by the word of the Lord through Jeremiah the prophet. He would accomplish 70 years of desolations in Jerusalem. Now, a comment about Jeremiah that he's referring to comes, it looks like it comes from 2 Chronicles 36:21. But based on the books, rest of the Bible, and what Jeremiah said, Daniel then started to gain understanding. And one of the reasons we need to know which books are books of the Old Testament, or New Testament for that matter, is so we can have proper understanding. Now, the Hebrew term translated books in Daniel 2 is bak parim. And I'd like to read some things regarding what the Jews think in terms of the books of the Old Testament, what we call the Old Testament. Now, I'm going through a lot of information here that's going to become, that comes from the Jewish Encyclopedia of 1906. And so we're going to read something what it talks about canon and books. Bible canon. It says the Greek word canon, and that's kata, alpha, nu, omega, nu. I know a little Greek. Meaning primarily a straight rod. Derivatively a norm or law was first applied by the so-called church fathers to the collection of Holy Scriptures, primarily those called the Old Testament. Now, actually, this Jewish source is the first time they used that expression was 360 A.D., and I have a reason to suspect it could have actually been more like around 180 A.D. or so. We'll get to that. Says, but the Jewish literature didn't really have anything like that, and the word canon was never part of the rabbinical vocabulary. It's quite certain that the idea expressed is designated as canonical writings, both including and as excluding certain books, is of Jewish origin. The designation Apocrypha affords a parallel instance. The word is Greek, the conception is Jewish. Again, I'm going through the Jewish Encyclopedia of 1906. And one of the reasons I'm going through the Jewish writings is because I already read to you what Paul wrote in the book of Romans about the Jews were given the oracles of God. And when you see other historical writings, a lot of times it referred to the Jews. So if not looking at what some of the Jews think about this could be helpful. Anyway, it says the idea of canonicity can only have been suggested at a period when national literature had progressed far enough to possess a large number of works from which a selection might be made. And when the need became more urgent, the Jewish mind occupied itself in producing exclusively the writings of religious import, which writings were included in the recognized collection, etc. The oldest and most frequent designation for the whole collection of biblical writings is the term books, which I gave you the Hebrew word of that a few moments ago. This word, which is in Daniel 9:2, which is what I was reading, means all the sacred writings. Occurs frequently in the Mishnah, which is something not part of the Old Testament, as well as in traditional literature without closer definition. The expression holy books belongs to later authors. It was employed first by medieval exegetes, people who were explaining things. They give a few sources for that. This goes to the fact that ancients regarded the whole mass of national religious writings as equally holy. The Jewish translation of the word is Ta Biblia. And it was also used in a non-biblical book to designate the whole of scriptures. Anyway, going again through the Jewish information. The canonical books, therefore, need no special designation since originally all were holy. So the Jews are saying, look, we just knew from the beginning which ones were holy. A new term had to be coined for the new idea of non-holy books. The latter were called the outside or extraneous books. That is, the books that weren't considered part of the established collection. A distinction that was made later. Possibly the designation due to the fact that the Apocrypha, which in popular estimation ranked nevertheless with religious works, were not included in the libraries of the temples and the synagogues. So in other words, there was a period of time after the Old Testament was basically written that some other books came out. There were also some during that time, but most of the ones called the Apocrypha came out afterwards. And people thought they were interesting or important, but they weren't in the temple, and the Jews and the Jewish leadership predominantly did not consider them to be sacred. It says, now, fourth designation for the entire Bible is Torah, or Law. And this designation owes its origin to the opinion that the entire Holy Writ is the Word of God, and the prophets and the Hagiographa are included in the Torah. I'll explain some of that in a few moments here. Testament. The fifth designation, literally, is it is written. It's frequently found personified. And it's from this that they say that the Christian world got this idea of the Testament from that expression. Other expressions. In post-Talmudic times, Other designations were sometimes used. Sometimes the Old Testament was called the 24 books. They had other types of abbreviations as well. Now, contents and divisions. Again, this is from the Jewish Encyclopedia. I will be getting to more scriptures, and I'll get into more to Christian and other literature later. But again, let's go through what the Jewish say. So the Jewish canon comprises 24 books. The five of the Pentateuch. Penta means five, and basically it's the first five books of the Bible. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, the first five. Then it says the eight books of the prophets. Listen to this. Joshua, Judges, Samuel, Kings, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and the minor prophets. And the 11 hagiographa, that means holy writings, Psalms, Proverbs, Job, Song of Solomon, Ruth, Lamentations, Ecclesiastes, Esther, Daniel, Ezra, and Chronicles. Samuel and Kings form but a single book each, as is seen in Aquila's Greek translation. The 12 prophets were known as one book, and the separation from Ezra from Nehemiah is not indicated either in the Talmud or the Masorah. So, in other words, when we look at the Old Testament, and this particular Bible, now this is the New King James translation of the Bible. There are 39 books listed. These 39 are the same as the 24, if you will, that the Jews had. But again, they put the 12 prophets together, they put Ezra and Nehemiah together, they put Samuel and Kings together. Now because of all this, they have a different in count. And so that can be confusing for some people who take a look at it. Anyway, it says these books are arranged in the three subdivisions, the Torah, Prophets, and the Hagiographa. So in this case, the Torah, instead of being all the Bible, it's the first five books as well, just the first five books. Earlier prophets, again, this is from the Jewish Encyclopedia. By the former expression, the Talmud, now the Talmud is a writing outside of the Bible, Jewish writing, understands that the older prophets, such as Isaiah, are distinguished from the later prophets like Haggai, Zechariah, Malachi, in contradistinction to the last three. Samuel, David, and Solomon are sometimes called the old prophets. Okay, people don't usually think of David and Solomon in that respect, but this is what the Jews said. The entire Holy Writ is also designated by the term Torah and the prophets. Still another division is Torah and Mikra. Mikra is used as a general term for the prophets and the Hagiographa. Again, means holy writings. Now the third division, Hagiographa, means holy writings. And I said that. It may have received its name in a similar way. Originally, the whole Bible was called holy writings, which makes sense, because that's what we consider it. But subsequently, men perhaps spoke of the law and the prophets. We know Jesus used that expression. And other holy writings, and then finally, briefly, of the holy writings. Similarly, the name writings is probably an abbreviation of the fuller expression from other writings or holy writings. To be considered conversant, the Bible had one had to be able to read accurately the Torah, the prophets, and the Hagiographa, according to the Jewish sources. Just as the Torah is threefold, so Israel is threefold, consisting of priests, Levites, and Israelites. And that's not really from Scripture that way, but okay. Okay, number of books. Again, this is from the Jewish Encyclopedia. And by the way, if I go too quickly over some parts of this and you want more information about it, there's a couple of sources I can refer you to. One, we had an article on the Old Testament canon in the Bible News Prophecy magazine for April, June of 2013. As a matter of fact, you can see it's mentioned here, the canon of the Old Testament. And you can find this magazine at the ccog.org website. and you, and there's a bunch of magazines, but this particular issue you can find there and read through it. But also, if you wish, you can go to the www.cogwriter.com website. It's cogwriter.com website. And all the stuff, I'm going to go through. I mean, I do explain some things that are not in the articles, but when I'm reading things from the article or summarizing things in the article, they're there if you want to get more information. Anyway, getting back to this, this is from the Jewish Encyclopedia under the number of the books. Canaanite literature makes no mention anywhere of the number of biblical books. And in the Old Testament, we don't see it listed someplace that there were X number of books that way. It does not seem to have been usual to pay attention to their number. This is felt to be of importance only when holy writings were to be distinguished from others, or when the entire range was to be explained to non-Jews. Now, the Jewish Encyclopedia says that Epiphanius, now he was a Catholic historical writer, late 4th century, division of the number 94 is 72 plus 22. I also say that, as it says here from a non-biblical book, it says that the number is 24. But anyway, but Epiphanius, the historian, came up with this 72 plus 22, while Jerome mentions 22, but nevertheless counts 24. Since both of those so-called church fathers studied under Jewish teachers, it's probable that some of the authorities in the synagogue favored counting 22 books, and the hesitation between 22 and 24 can be explained based on the fact that sometimes some things are put together, like Ruth with Judges, or some that kind of a thing. Because what they did back then, they didn't have pages. Yeah, like there's pages here. They didn't have pages, they had rolls. And sometimes maybe they would put a short book on the same roll as a long one, as a longer one or another one. And that's basically what the Jewish Encyclopedia says. That's why there was a difference between the count of so-called 22 or 24. And they go through lots of different reasons and try to give some logic. Like they're saying, for example, that because number 7 talks about 24 sacrificial animals, therefore that means 24 books of the Old Testament. I don't believe that you can base it on that, but anyway, that's their particular logic. And some Jewish sources are saying, 24 books I've written to you, you don't need to add any to it. And the reality is, there are what they call 24, if you spread them all out into their individual pieces, it comes out to be 39. Again, because they put all the minor, so-called minor prophets together, and they combine a lot of other books together, and that's how they came up with it. The sequence. Now this you might find interesting. The sequence that we have here is not the same sequence that the Jews had. For example, the sequence of the prophets starts with Joshua, then Judges, then Samuel, then Kings, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, then Isaiah. Well, the way ours come out, it's Isaiah, Jeremiah, then Ezekiel, but there it's Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Isaiah. The 12 minor prophets, that of the Agiographa, that is Ruth, Psalms, Job, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon, Lamentations, Daniel, Esther, Ezra, Chronicles. So, and of course, by the way, they do start off with Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. So the sequence of the books that the Jews had, the way they understood the sequence to be, is not the same sequence that is in most Bibles used by the Church of God, Catholics or Protestants. There are some who've attempted to put books, Bibles together along that line, but anyway, most of the ones that have been printed, I can assure you, don't follow this particular order. And then they say, who wrote the books? Moses wrote his book. They also say that he wrote the section on Balaam and Job. It says Joshua wrote his book. Samuel wrote his book, Judges and Ruth. David wrote the Psalms. Well, there are some others who probably did some of these things. Again, this is pretty much, some of this is biblical, some of this is speculation. It said Jeremiah wrote his book, the Book of Kings and Lamentations. King Hezekiah and his council who survived him wrote Isaiah. Isaiah may have written that. Proverbs, Song of Solomon, and Ecclesiastes. The man of the great synagogue wrote Ezekiel, the 12 prophets, Daniel, Esther, Ezra. And Ezra wrote the book, wrote his book, in the genealogy of Chronicles down himself. Some of the stuff that the Jews think, and this is accurate, some of it they're just basically speculating. Basically, everybody within the Jewish world agrees that the first five books of the Bible, the Law of the Torah, was the first and oldest part of the canon. And they believe that Nehemiah describes the actual canon as far as some kind of a collection of it back in that time. Now, here's something that the Jews say. This is interesting because this is from the Jewish Encyclopedia. The Jews say, the New Testament shows that its canon was none other than the canon which exists today. What does that mean? What the Jews are saying is that when you look at the New Testament, it talks about the same 24, 39 books that are used today. It says, none of the Apocrypha or Pseudepocrypha are ever quoted by name. Well, Daniel is expressly cited in Matthew 24:15, Matthew 13:35, Luke 11:51 proves that Chronicles was the last canonical book. And they quote various parts of the New Testament to say this proves that at the time of Jesus, the 24 books that the Jews accept as inspired currently, which are the same as the 39 books that we in the continuing Church of God accept, were the same ones that Jesus and his disciples and stuff used. So they're basically saying in the Roman province of Judea, which later became called Palestine, that they used the same books of the Old Testament that we in the continuing Church of God use now and that the Jews currently use. And then they say that Josephus, who was around from around 38 to 95 AD, he enumerates the 22 books. He told us that why there's this difference between 22 and 24, just the beginning on if they put them on the same roll or something. And as far as Josephus, I'd like to actually read what Josephus wrote. And yes, I know I'm going through a fair amount of reading. And Josephus wrote, for we have not an innumerable multitude of books among us, disagreeing from and contradicting each other, as the Greeks have. So Josephus, writing in the early first century, or sometime the first century, said, look, we're not like the Greeks, the different books disagree. We only have so many books, and these are the ones that are it. But we only have 22 books, which contain the records of all the past times, and which are justly believed to be divine. So at the time of Josephus, the 22, 24 books, which are again the 39 books that we accept currently, today, those were divine as far as Josephus was concerned. And of them, five belong to Moses. I mentioned that before. Which contains his laws and traditions of the origin of mankind till his death. This interval of time was a little short of 3,000 years, but it's the time of the death of Moses to the reign of Artaxerxes, king of Persia, who reigned after Xerxes, the prophets, written after Moses. He wrote down what was done in this time in 13 books. Well, this king of Persia that he's talking about, we're talking this somewhere around 475, 457 BC. About 457 BC, Ezra was sent by King Artaxerxes to Jerusalem. And then what we commonly call the Old Testament seemed to have been finished or completed during the days of Ezra the priest, as well as Nehemiah the governor. Probably was finished around 420 BC. So as far as the Jewish world was concerned, the truly divinely inspired books of the Bible were finished by 420 BC. So roughly 400 and some years, just 400 some years before Jesus, roughly 450 years before Jesus was killed and resurrected. Anyway, it says that the remaining four books contain hymns to God and the precepts of the conduct of human life. So we're talking about, I'm sure, Proverbs and such. 'Tis true, our history has been written since Artaxerxes, very particularly, but has not been esteemed of like authority with the former by our forefathers. So in other words, Josephus said, yeah, there were some other books that were written after 420, but we didn't count those as the same situation. We consider them more like historically accurate books. Like, for example, there are certain accounts of the U.S. Revolution against Britain. There are certain facts in there. If those facts are correct, they're correct. They're not the Word of God, but you can still have things that are right that aren't the Word of God. Use that as an example. Anyway, it says, they were not considered or esteemed of like authority with the former by our forefathers, because there has not been an exact succession of prophets since that time. So basically, he said the reason was that there were no other prophets God had put out since then, and since there were no other prophets that they accepted, they didn't accept any more books. And how firmly we have given credit to these books for our own nation is evident by what we do. In other words, he says, look, we really believe the first, he called them 22, but we'll call them the first 39 books of this, are true, so true that we do things based on them. We rest in the Sabbath, we keep the holy days, we avoid unclean meats, etc., etc., etc. We do it because that's how much we actually esteem this particular book. For during so many ages as already passed, no one has been so bold as to either add anything to them or take anything from them or to make any change in them. And the Jews are very careful. In the New Testament, we hear about people called scribes. What the scribes were people who could write and who were writing down what the Bible said, what the Old Testament said. They would write it down, and they had a system. They would count how many characters, etc., and try to count them when they're done to see if they had it right. They did a remarkable job of keeping the accuracy. This is book for thousands of years from to now. Anyway, it says they didn't make any changes to them, but it became natural to all Jews immediately from the very birth to esteem these books that contain divine doctrines. You know, all Scripture, it says in the New Testament, Paul wrote in 1 Timothy, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God. It's profitable for correction, instruction, righteousness, etc. And he says, look, from the get-go, from birth, they have birth, when Jews are born, they know that this is what they're supposed to believe. Of course, I'm sure the day they're born, they don't actually know anything, but hopefully their parents are instilling respect for the Word of God, and this is what he says they were doing. And to persist in the doctrines of these divine doctrines, and if occasion be willing to die for them. Okay, to suffer, to need be for them. For 'tis no new thing for our captives, many of them in number, and frequently in time, to be seen to endure racks and deaths of all kinds upon the theaters, that they may not be obliged to say one word against our laws and the records that contain them. Whereas there are none at all among the Greeks who would undergo the least harm on that account. So he's saying here, look, we so willingly believe this. We are willing to die, to suffer because of this. So you Greeks, you've got all kinds of writings, but you guys aren't going to die or something for your writings. You don't consider them to that kind of a standard to have to live according to that way. Anyway, the Jews take them to be such discourses as are framed agreeably to the inclination of those who wrote them. In other words, he says, look, the Jews, they wrote books. And, you know, it's somebody's opinion, and, you know, people, you know, say, oh, yeah, we like this. And so they agreed that this is kind of good to read. And there's all kinds of stories outside the Bible to read. And I've read, you know, Greek stories. And many of you are probably familiar with some stories such as story of Troy. Let's see, Homer wrote that. The Odyssey, the Iliad and the Odyssey. Those are historical writings at the time. And there's other stories throughout history. And they, the Jews, have just the same opinion of the elder writers, since they see some of the generation bold enough to write about such affairs when they weren't present. They didn't concern themselves in form who know them. Examples of which could be this late war of ours. Some people have written histories, they published them without having been there or having been near them, and the actions were done. But these men put a few things together by hearsay. And some of them call these writings by the name of histories. So basically, Josephus said, look, we have these books, not an innumerable amount of books, like the Greeks do. And by the way, the Greeks at that time were considered the educated and the educators. What does that mean? That means that a lot of the Romans learned from Greeks, and they've studied Greek philosophers, and the Greeks had come up with various forms of mathematics and certain principles of physics. And so most of the literature in the Western world, a lot of it at least, probably the vast majority of it, was written in Greek. And there are lots and lots and lots of books. And some were considered religious, some were not considered not religious, but basically they weren't considered holy the way the Bible is considered. At least that was Josephus' opinion. Now, it doesn't mean that there weren't any Jews, not any Greeks, excuse me, any Romans or any Greeks who didn't consider some parts of their passages inspired. I'm sure that there were some. It also doesn't mean there weren't any Jews who didn't accept some of the writings that came after 420 AD, excuse me, BC, after 420 BC as inspired. Undoubtedly there were some, but Josephus said, look, they're not inspired. These are the last ones. This is it. This is how we are. The other writings are like Greeks, your other writings. They're just someone's opinions, and they wrote some stuff down. As far as what's inspired, what we believe is the Word of God, what's divinely inspired, what we live for, what we live by, what we would die for. Those are what we would call today the 39 books of the Old Testament, not the additional ones. Now, I'd like to read something from a 20th century Catholic scholar by the name of Bellarmino Bagatti. And he confirmed the idea, well, he referred to another document that confirmed the idea that between the 2nd and 4th centuries, that even the Greco-Roman churches accepted that the 39 books of the Bible, of the Old Testament, were the actual books. So let me read something that Priest Bagatti wrote. He said, the preservation of the text among the Jews gave occasion to the anonymous author of Exhortations to the Greeks. Now, this is what was written between the 2nd and 4th century. No one's totally sure exactly when it came to draw this conclusion. And here's what the Exhortation to the Greeks said. This is what Bagatti wrote. Today, also, the Jews guard the books that belong to our religion. So, a Greco-Roman Christian-type person said, when he wrote this, again, 2nd to 4th century, that today also the Jews guard the books that belong to our religion. Now, he wasn't referring to the New Testament, because the Jews, he didn't think, were guarding those particularly, I would think. But he said the Jews guard the books that belong to our religion, which is consistent with what the Apostle Paul wrote in Romans chapter 3, verses 1 through 2. Anyway, we start back on this. Again, this is from Exhortations to the Greeks. Today also the Jews guard the books which belong to our religion. This was a work of divine providence for our advantage, so as to not give rise to suspicion of any falsity to those who wish to speak ill of us when we bring them from the church. And therefore, we wished to bring them to the synagogue of the Jews, so that from these books, guarded also by them, it may be evident that the laws written by holy men for teaching clearly and evidently belong to us. So what this Greco-Roman writer was saying is, look, we use the same books that the Jews preserved, that God preserved them through the Jews. And I mentioned again, Romans 3:1. So he's referring to that, and so the Greco-Roman said those are the only ones that counted. Those are the ones that were part of the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints. Now, Priest Bugatti, in another part of his writing, he acknowledged that when Melito of Sardis, who was a Church of God leader in the second century, when he went down to verify the list or the canon of the Old Testament, he went over to the area of Judea-Palestine. He didn't go into Egypt. And Melito held basically what we call a Church of God doctrines, even though the Church of Rome considers him to be one of their saints. Sometimes they've appropriated saints to their church who are actually part of the Church of God. Now, the Jewish Encyclopedia, I'm going to get back to that, from 1906, claims that all evidence supports the following from a writer named Zunc, is correct. Quote, long before the destruction of the temple, 70 AD is when that would have happened, and not long after Sirach was translated, the holy writings comprised their present cycle. So in other words, long before the temple was destroyed, they knew what the books were, and it's these 39 books. And now the Jewish Encyclopedia also teaches, quote, neither the Ben Sira or any of the books written thereafter are canonical. So it was known, or the Jews believed, and still believe, that again, it was all finished about 420 AD. Now, I'd like to read something from the Companion Bible. This is from Appendix 30 of it. Now, what we call the Old Testament is also called the Masoretic Text. And so here's what the Companion Bible says about it. The text itself had been fixed before the Masoretes were put in charge of it. That's why they call it the Masoretic Text. It was already fixed, but then a group called the Masoretes had it. The Masoretes were authorized custodians of it. Their work was to preserve it. The Masorah is called a fence to the scriptures because it locked in all words and letters in their places. It records the number of times several letters occur in the various books of the Bible, the number of the words and the middle word and the number of the verses in the middle verse, for the set purpose of safeguarding the sacred text and preventing the loss and misplacement of a single word or letter. And that's what I was saying before. That's what the scribes were to do when they copied. They had a system so they knew how many characters to go back and count, etc., to be sure they did it right. Why? Because they considered it the Word of God, and they realized they were human beings, and as human beings they could make mistakes. And they didn't want any mistakes in the Word of God. They didn't want people to rely on their mistakes of omission or commission. So that's why they counted it. You know, so this is talking about the meticulous detail that was done to preserve the book. So I recently saw some nonsense article on the news trying to explain how the Bible was all changed and all this kind of stuff. The reality is there's more proof for the scriptures being accurate than any other ancient writings of these periods. There's more copies of them. There's more copies that agree word for word. Yes, occasionally there are some minor differences. Basically, they agree fully. As far as for doctrine and instruction, righteousness, etc., the Bibles we have are complete. Sometimes there are some translation errors, but other than that, the Bibles that we have are complete. Complete enough for us that we can function as Christians today if we're willing to live by and believe every word of God. And again, part of the purpose of this particular sermon is to help you better understand what books are the Word of God. Now, You know, it says in Matthew 17:12, there were still scribes in Jesus' day, and they copied and counted and all those kinds of things. Now, I'd like to read something from the acclaim from the Catholic Encyclopedia. There's a smaller or incomplete or larger or complete Old Testament, is what it's claiming. Both of these were handed down by the Jews. So they're saying, okay, there were two sets of books by the Jews. The former by the Palestinian, the latter by the Alexandrian or Hellenist Jews. So the Church of Rome is saying there were two sets of books. The Palestinian books, which is the books that Jesus used, and the Alexandrian ones, which again, the modern Jews don't acknowledge those either as legitimate. Anyway, it says the Jewish Bible today is composed of three divisions. The Law, the Prophets, and the Writings. This is supposed to have been long established in the Mishnah, the Jewish Code of Unwritten Sacred Laws. Now, as far as the Jews go, I want to say that it's believed that they had a council, and there's some argument on whether or not this happened. It's the Council of Jamnia. This is believed to have occurred around 90 AD, because allegedly there was a discussion, are these Alexandrian extra books legitimate or not? And the conclusion was they were not. Now, as I read from other Jewish sources, the Jewish records say, look, it was known way before this. It was known before the destruction of the temple. From 420 on, there were no new books. Now, as far as this council or school of Jamnia, some question whether it happened or not, but I'd like to actually read a little bit of what the Catholic Encyclopedia says about this. It says, following the destruction of the Second Temple in 70 AD, it's again from the Catholic Encyclopedia, Rabbi Johanan ben Zakkai relocated to the city of Jamnia, also known as Javni, and founded a school of Jewish law there. The school is often understood to be the foundation of rabbinical Judaism, as opposed to priestly Judaism, which had existed before. The notion of a council of Jamnia is a hypothetical notion which was first introduced by Heinrich Geitz in 1871. He did this based on various sources that there had been a definitive council which had decided and settled the Jewish canon sometime late into the first century AD. This is the prevailing scholarly census for most of the consensus for most of the 20th century. However, from 1960s onward, this is not from the Catholic Encyclopedia. This is from a Catholic source. I'm sorry, because the Catholic Encyclopedia wasn't from there. This is on the Septuagint. Based on the work of Jack P. Lice and some others, this was called into question. They were not sure whether they did this or not. However, whether or not there was an actual Council of Jamnia, the outcomes attributed to the Council of Jamnia certainly did occur, whether gradually or definitively, whether or not there was a council. And here's what emerged. So they're saying, look, whether or not there was an actual Council of Jamnia between 87 and 90 AD, says we're not sure. This is from a Catholic source. But here's what we do know. The rejection of the Septuagint or the Koine Greek Old Testament, widely then in use among the Hellenized diaspora. Let me explain this for a second. What they're saying is that there were books called the Septuagint, which had extra books. Septuagint was written in Greek. Jews who knew Greek were considered to be Hellenized, because that's closer to the word, the Greek word actually for Greek itself. And they kept them. And also, because of some passages cursing the Christians, this they think came out of this council. Whether that came out of the council or not is irrelevant. But what is believed is, even the Church of Rome supporters say that the Jews didn't accept the Septuagint books. Now, the Septuagint books did include the 39 legitimate books, but then they included a bunch of other books, and we'll talk about those in a little bit. Now, I'd like to read something from a Church of Rome supporter who spent time in Asia Minor, known as Irenaeus of Lyon. He ended up in Lyon, which is in southern France. And he wrote this in his Against Heresies, Book 4, Chapter 32, Verses 1 and 2. After this fashion also did a presbyter, or an elder, a disciple of the apostles, reason with respect to the two testaments, proving that they were truly from one and the same God. So he said there were two testaments, an Old and a New Testament. He says, for all the apostles taught that there were indeed two testaments among the two peoples, but that it was one and the same God who appointed both for the advantage of those men for whose sake those testaments were given, who were to believe in God. Now, I want to bring this out because Irenaeus is saying that the apostles knew which books were the Old Testament, which I said, they were from the area of Judea-Palestine, therefore they used the 39 books that we currently use, and that they knew the New Testament. It's interesting. Now, when Irenaeus uses the term the presbyter, a disciple of the apostles, he's talking about somebody who is a disciple of the apostles who knew the different testaments. This is probably a reference to Polycarp of Smyrna. It's also possible it could be related to Melito of Sardis, although he may have been too old to himself to actually know the apostles, but it's possible that he actually did know them. But again, Irenaeus, who is considered a saint by the Greco-Roman churches, said from the beginning, the apostles knew which books were the books of the Old Testament and which books were the book of the New Testament because they knew which ones were which. And one of their disciples, an elder who knew them as well and taught the same thing. So Irenaeus is saying that the Church of God knew which were the books of the Bible from the beginning, which is the position of the continuing Church of God. Before the time of the death of the Apostle John, and I mention the Apostle John because he penned the last book of the Bible, which is the book of Revelation. By the time he died, he would have known all the books of the Bible and passed them on to some of his disciples, such as Polycarp. Now, I'd like to go further into that and mention that there's this document. It's known as the Heres Fragments. It came out probably in the 2nd or 3rd century. Now, Polycarp lived until roughly 160 AD, plus or minus. Some books say it's 155. I've seen some as late as 180. Somewhere in that time frame. So that's in the 2nd century. Anyway, basically, the Heres Fragments stress Polycarp's connection to the Apostle John, which is important because there are some modern scholars who say the Apostle John and Polycarp were not connected because there was not enough writings that said that there were. Well, these other writings called the Heres Fragments were uncovered and they make that connection. The problem with them, and the reason they're called fragments, and I've looked at them, I actually have a book that has them all in there, is there'll be some words or something missing. So basically, like, imagine a piece of paper with some holes in it. And that's basically what it was. So sometimes we don't have all the words. That's why they're called fragments. But let me read from the Heres Fragments. Now, this was translated, I think, by Frederico Weidman. It says, there remained after him, this is after the Apostle John, a disciple, name was Polycarp, and he, that's John, made him bishop over Smyrna. Now, a bishop is a pastor, overseeing pastor. He was an old man, being 104 years of age. So this is something else that says that Polycarp lived to be 104. He, that's Polycarp, continued to walk in the canons, which he learned from his youth from John the Apostle. So this is interesting. This is the first time in the literature that I see the term canons. And I find it interesting because of two things. One, when I looked at the Greek, it looks like the word is actually plural, which is canons, which suggests that perhaps it's saying that he knew both the Old Testament canon and the New Testament canon, which would make sense because, as I said a few moments ago, the Apostle John was the last of the apostles to die. He was the last of the apostles, or last to anyone that God inspired to write in the books that are within this book, the 66 books of the Old New Testament. So he had reason to have to know everything. I mean, John knew Jesus. Jesus gave him a revelation at the end. And he wrote things down, and he would have had the books, and he passed them on to Polycarp. So we see that the canons or the measuring rods were passed to Polycarp. Now, does this absolutely prove that this said that Polycarp had the canon of the Old and New Testament? Well, that's a little tricky to say for absolute certain, because the term canon means measuring rod. But by implication, the answer is actually yes. Because we're supposed to be set apart by the Word of God. That's what we're to be measured by. We're supposed to be judged by the things out of the book, as it says in the other books, as it says in the book of Revelation. And the books are the Bible. So I believe that Polycarp did get the canons. This is certainly additional historical evidence, or at least a historical report, that he did. Now, Polycarp was in Smyrna, which is in Asia Minor, and there's a list of leaders from Asia Minor that we have written by Polycrates. Polycrates wrote a letter to the Bishop of Rome, basically telling the Bishop of Rome he had to obey God rather than men. But in this list, he lists different leaders whom he followed after. He lists the Apostle John, then he lists Polycarp, Melito, Sigeras, Thrasius, Papirius, etc., and then he lists himself. Polycrates was a bishop or overseeing pastor in the area of Ephesus. Like Smyrna, Ephesus is one of the seven churches of Revelation chapters 2 and 3. Now, here's what he wrote, probably around 193 AD. So this is near the end of the second century. He wrote, "I therefore, brethren, who have lived 65 years in the Lord and have met with brethren throughout the world, have gone through every holy scripture." Oh, well, how did he go through every holy scripture if he didn't have them or know what they were? He said, "I went through every holy scripture." So he read them all, which, by the way, means not only should you know what the books are, you should know what's in them. So we would hope and pray that you will read what's in the Bible, because that's what you should do. He says, "I didn't bear my gray hairs in vain. I've always governed my life by the Lord Jesus." And he would have agreed with the biblical canon that Melito put together, which I'm going to get to in a moment. But I'd like to make a comment about those who aren't sure when the canon happened. This is from James Moffat's review. He says, "Was not the apostolic canon of scriptures first formed in Asia Minor?" That is correct. The Apostle John died in Asia Minor. Polycarpus from Asia Minor, Melito, etc. And most of the books of the New Testament, by the way, were written to or from people in Asia Minor. Now, I'd like to read something from Melito of Sardis. I think what happened was in the second century, some people asked him about the Septuagint and asked him about some of these other books. And he decided to do an investigation of them to try to determine once and for all, or to prove to people who gave him some arguments, that no, the only books of the Old Testament are the ones that we already accepted. So he wrote a letter. This is from the Book of Extracts. He says, "Melito, to his brother Onesimus, greetings. As you've often prompted by your regard for the Word of God, expressed a wish to have some extracts made from the Law and the Prophets concerning the Savior and concerning our faith in general, and a desire, moreover, to obtain an accurate account of the ancient books as to regard of their number and their arrangement." So he said, "I'm going to tell you the number and their order. "I've striven to the best of my ability to perform this task, well knowing your zeal for the faith and your eagerness to become acquainted with the Word. especially because I am assured that through your yearnings after God, you esteem these things beyond all else, engaged as you are in a struggle for eternal salvation. We're all, if we're Christians, we're in a struggle for eternal salvation. He says, I accordingly proceeded to the east. And I went to the very spot where the things in question were preached and took place. And Jerusalem is somewhat east of, south too, of Sardis. And I, having made myself accurately acquainted with the books of the Old Testament. Now, I want to say here, this, Melito just called them the Old Testament. It's probably the first, maybe one of the first places we actually see the term Old Testament used. Anyway, I set them down below, and here with send you the list. And there as follows. The five books of Moses, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. Then he says, Joshua, Judges, Ruth, the four books of Kings, the two of Chronicles. So see, he separated them, unlike how the Jews were doing it. The book of the Psalms of David, the Proverbs of Solomon, also called the Book of Wisdom. Ecclesiastes, the Song of Songs. Job, the books of the prophets. Isaiah, Jeremiah, of the 12 contained a single book. Daniel, Ezekiel, Ezra. From these, I've made my extracts, dividing them into six books. And so the Catholic Encyclopedia, by the way, when they saw Melito's list, they said that none of their extra books, which they call the Deuterocanonicals, are in this list. That only books that Melito referred to were the same books, the 39 books, that we in the Continuing Church of God use, other Church of God groups use, and most Protestants use. Now, the fact that Melito calls these books the Old Testament shows that these are the entire Old Testament. He doesn't think the extra apocryphal books are part of the Old Testament. Now, if you look at his list of books, and you won't be able to see this from here, but it's I've got the first five plus one plus one plus one plus four plus two plus blah, 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 blah. Anyway, you add all these up. It adds up with 39 books, which is the same number as the modern New Testament. So if you want to see my math, you can go and look at this. And there's an Anglican scholar who said that the fragment from Melito is significant as the first Christian Old Testament canon. It's also interesting that Melito went to Palestine, and thus it's an indication that it's in the Old Testament canon known by the Palestinian Christians and perhaps the Jews. And when you look at what the Catholic Encyclopedia, by the way, says about Melito's list, it says, Melito, while maintaining a familiar arrangement of the Septuagint, he says he verified his catalog by inquiry among the Jews. The Jews by that time, had everywhere discarded the Alexandrian books, and Melito's canon consisted exclusively of the proto-canonicals minus Esther. And they think that Esther wasn't in there for political reasons, but I think Esther was in there. By my count, I came up with it. And this is from the Catholic Encyclopedia. St. Jerome, speaking of the canon of Melito, and that's the same canon that we accept in the Continuing Church of God, quotes Tertullian's statement that he, that's Melito, was esteemed a prophet by many of the faithful. And Melito was probably the last person referred to in Catholic accepted writings as a prophet that we in the Continuing Church of God would have accepted as one of God's prophets. Okay. Now what about other books? Well, basically the Catholics say that Justin Martyr, he said that there's some differences in your scriptures. And basically, because of that, the Catholics say, well, this means there were other books that they were supposed to use. But if you look at what Justin Martyr said, and I'm not going to take the time to go through this now. Basically, he said that the Jews took some things away. He didn't say that they added anything. Now, what about the so-called canonical books? What about those, the extra books that the Catholics use? Now, the Catholics like to say they gave the world the Bible, and they'll show you the Latin Vulgate that was put together by Jerome. Jerome is considered a saint by the Church of Rome and the Eastern Orthodox, and a doctor of the Church by them as well. And did he put together a book that contained the extra books? Yes. But did he believe them? No. Then why did he put them in there? Because he said he had to. He did not believe them. He said they weren't valid. So let me read you something from the Catholic Encyclopedia. It says, St. Jerome casts his weighty suffrage on the side unfavorable to the disputed books. Jerome lived long in Palestine, in an environment where everything outside the Jewish canon was suspect. And moreover, he had an excessive veneration for the Hebrew text. Excessive veneration? You would think that he would believe it because that's the way God inspired it. The inferior rank to which the Deuteros were relegated by authorities like Origen, Athanasius, and Jerome, he said, they were too rigid in what they thought should be the books of the Bible. Well, Origen is considered a great theologian by the Church of Rome and the Eastern Orthodox and by a lot of Protestants. He didn't accept it. And Athanasius is their hero when it comes to the Trinity, and he didn't accept these extra books as valid as well. But as far as Jerome goes, I'm going to actually read something. Jerome wrote a preface before several books when he was translating them. And here's what he wrote about this one, the book of Judith. Judith is not in this Bible. It's in the Catholic Bibles. It's not in this one, Roman Catholic Bibles, Eastern Orthodox. Among the Jews, the book of Judith is considered among the Apocrypha. Its warrant for affirming those apocryphal texts, which have come down to us into dispute, is deemed less than sufficient. Moreover, since it was written in the Chaldean language, it is counted among the historical books. But since the Nicene Council is considered to have counted the book among the sacred scriptures, I have acquiesced to your request, or should I say demand, and my other works set aside, from which I was forcibly restrained. I have given a single night's work translating according to the sense rather than verbatim. So he called it apocryphal. He said he didn't consider it sacred. Now here's what he wrote before the book of Tobias, which is again something else that he is in the Apocrypha. I do not cease to wonder at the constancy of your demanding. For you demand that I bring you a book written in Chaldean words into Latin. Indeed, the book of Tobias, which the Hebrews exclude from their catalog of divine scriptures, being mindful of those things which they have titled the Hagiographa. I have done enough for your desire, yet not by my study, for the studies of the Hebrews rebuke us and find fault with us to translate this for the ears of Latins contrary to their canon. So Jerome says, look, the Jews tell us, don't do this, this is false. And he also wrote something else. And this is his apology against Rufinus, book 2, Jerome writes. In reference to Daniel, I also told the reader that the version read in the Christian churches was not that of Septuagint translator, but that of Theodotion. Which is, he's saying that the Theodotion one is basically the Jewish one. It's true, I said, the Septuagint version was in this book very different from the original, and that was condemned by the right judgment of the churches of Christ. In other words, he said that the early Roman Catholic churches, and the Catholic churches, condemned things like Bel and the Dragon and other additions to the book of Daniel, which are in the Catholic, Roman, and Eastern Orthodox Catholic Bible, not in the real Bible. I repeat what the Jews say against the story of Susanna and the hymn of the three children and the fables of Bel and the Dragon, which are not contained in the Hebrew Bible. Now, also, he wrote the following. He says, the Hebrew scriptures used by the apostolic men, they use as evident by the apostles and evangelists. Our Lord and Savior himself, when he refers to scriptures, takes his quotations from the Hebrews. He gives various reasons for this. And not certain things like given in the Septuagint. He says there's many cases. He said, I don't say this to make a blow at the 70 translators, but I assert the apostles of Christ have an authority superior to theirs. The 70 agree with the Hebrew. The apostles took their quotations from that translation. But when they disagree, they sat down in Greek to see what they sat down in Greek, what they found in Hebrew. In other words, Jerome's saying, look, the apostles, if they ever quoted the Septuagint, which is a Greek translation of the Hebrew into uh, well, actually the Hebrew and the Greek of the Old Testament. He said, as long as that agreed, they would just use that because it was fine. But if it didn't agree, they would go use the Hebrew and translate it to Greek because that was correct. And it was partially because, by the way, the Septuagint was changed. And oddly, the Greco-Roman churches believe when people translated the original Hebrew for the Septuagint into Greek, that God inspired them to fix mistakes that God had made originally writing it, having it inspired in Hebrew. And that's, of course, blasphemous, and that should not be relied upon. Now, Jerome wasn't the only one. Cyril of Jerusalem indicated the apocryphal books were less reliable. He said, we speak not from apocryphal books, but from Daniel. Talking about the time, times, and half a time. Okay? Now, read something from the Catholic Encyclopedia. It says, the canon of the Old Testament during the 4th and 1st half of the 5th century. In this period, the position of deuterocanonical literature is no longer secure. So in other words, the Catholic Church is saying in the 4th and 1st part of the 5th century, they weren't really accepting these extra books, which is interesting, because they shouldn't have, because obviously they should not, because they weren't part of the original books that were accepted. Then it says, from the period of the middle of the 5th century to the 17th century, this period exhibits a curious exchange of opinions between the West and the East. During this intermediate age, the use of Jerome's new version of the Old Testament, the Latin Vulgate, became widespread. With its text went Jerome's prefaces, the things he said at the beginning, disparaging the Deuterocanonicals. And under the influence of his authority, the West began to distrust them. And even the Latin Church throughout the Middle Ages, we find evidence of hesitation to use those extra books. So when were these books actually adopted? I'm going to read from the Catholic Encyclopedia so you won't think this is Catholic bashing or I'm making this up. He says the proto-canonical books of the Old Testament correspond with those of the Bible, the Hebrews, as well as what we in the Continuing Church of God use. And the Old Testament is received by the Protestants. The deuterocanonical, deuteros meaning second, are those scriptural character was contested in some quarters, but gained a secure footing in the Bible of the Catholic Church, though those Old Testaments are classified by Protestants as Apocrypha. Well, they're also classified by their saint and doctor of the Church, Jerome's Apocrypha, and others. It says they consist of seven books, Tobias or Tobit, Judith, Wisdom, Ecclesiasticus, Baruch 1 and 2, Maccabees, and three documents added to the proto-canonical books. A supplement to Esther, the Canticle of Three Youths, the Song of Three Children, the story of Susanna and the elders and Bela the dragon. The ancient Old Testament, the Greek Old Testament, known as Septuagint, was the vehicle which conveyed these additional scriptures into the Catholic Church. The Septuagint version was a Bible of the Greek-speaking or Hellenist Jews, whose intellectual and literary center was in Alexandria, Egypt. The old extant copies date from the 4th and 5th centuries of our time. The most explicit definition of the Catholic canon is that given by the Council of Trent, Session 4, in 1546. The order of the books copies that the Council of Florence, 1442, and its general plan is that of the Septuagint. So in other words, the Catholic Church said, they kind of came up with something in 1442, but weren't sure what to do about it, but the Council of 1546, they finally decided once and for all that the deuterocanonical books were supposedly scripture, even though previous writers said they weren't, even though Jesus didn't believe it, the apostles didn't believe it, Melito, who they called to be one of their saints, didn't believe it. They accepted them anyway. Now, I'd like to read something else about this from another writer. He says, there's a mistaken belief among some that the apocryphal books were part of the Bible and they were rejected by the Protestant reformers. It's on the contrary. The apocryphal books were never part of the Old Testament canon. Thus, it's not a question if the reformers dropped some books from the canon. Rather, it was the Roman Catholic Church which added these books to the canon by a proclamation made at the Council of Trent. And there's more writings on this, and this is an article called The Reliability of the Canon, which you can read at the article that I mentioned before. Now, I'd like to read something from the Eastern Orthodox Church. I'm going to read something from one of their bishops who said, "The Orthodox Church, as its authoritative text for the Old Testament, it uses the ancient Greek Septuagint. When this differs from the original Hebrew, which happens quite often, Orthodox believe that the changes of the Septuagint were made under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit and are to be accepted as part of God's continuing revelation." In other words, he's saying that the way God originally had it revealed or written down was not right. So he revealed more, and he inspired the translators, when they translated the Septuagint, to fix mistakes and to correct things. And that's what you call the Bible, even though that's not what Jesus taught or his disciples. "The Hebrew version of the Old Testament contains 39 books. That is correct, and that's what we in the Continuing Church of God accept. Septuagint contains an addition of 10 further books not present in the Hebrew, which are known in the Orthodox Church as the Deuterocanonical books. These were declared by the councils of Jassy in 1641 and Jerusalem in 1672 to be genuine parts of Scripture." So the Eastern Orthodox decided they were genuine once and for all in the 17th century. That wasn't part of the original church. "Most Orthodox scholars consider the Deuterocanonical books, although part of the Bible, they stand at a lower footing than the rest of the Scripture." Huh? They're saying that those books, they have them, but they're not in the same category as the rest of the Bible. Well, they either are or they're not. Well, they have them in there. They say, well, they're not as good, but they're inspired. No, if they're inspired by God, they're truly, totally inspired by God, then they're totally good, and they should be considered equal. But even the Eastern Orthodox scholars realize they're not equal, and they're not scriptural, and they shouldn't be in there. I mentioned Jerome a couple of times, and he met with people who have been Church of God Christians, we think. Groups of people, for example, called the Nazarenes. And Jerome said that the Nazarene Christians, the Church of God people, said, "God has given us the law and the testimonies of Scriptures." And Jerome wrote that he was friendly with, quote, "one of the Hebrews that believed." So while a lot of people think that the Catholic Church gave the world the Bible, what they forget is, where did the Catholic Church get the Bible? And Jerome was living in Palestine for a while, who was friendly with at least somebody who appears to be part of the Church of God. And that's where they got the Bible. The Catholics got the Bible from the Church of God. The Church of God had the books from the beginning. There are other historical records that I could go into along those lines. But basically, from the beginning, from the time of the Apostle John, through Polycarp, etc., the Church of God in Asia Minor had the full Bible. They knew what it was. So, well, if they knew what it was, then why did Melito go down to Jerusalem? Probably somebody found some reason, some report or something, and he was concerned and thought, okay, fine, I'll go down there. Maybe a heresy obviously was introduced, and he felt he had to deal with it. So he dealt with it once and for all, came up with a list. And even the Church of Rome admits that the list that he came up with is the same list that we in the Continuing Church of God use, when the one that the Protestants use. Now, this is indirectly admitted, by the way. We're going to read something from a 21st century account by Gerd Thiessen, he wrote, or Thiessen. "Therefore, we can advance hypothesis that above all those writings entered the canon on which the Christian communities of Asia Minor and Rome could agree." Okay, this is, in other words, the Church of Rome, for its canon, originally accepted the same thing the churches in Asia Minor taught. Then we found out later decades, they came up with a different version. Now, I'd like to go back to the Bible. Let's go to the book of Isaiah chapter 8, verse 16. It's a short passage, but I'd like you to get to it, because I'd like you to look at it, because this verifies what I've been saying about the Apostle John. Isaiah 8, verse 16 says, "Bind up the testimony," or the testaments, "seal the law among my disciples." The Bible was supposed to be sealed up by the disciples. Again, the last disciple to live is the Apostle John. We know that John knew Polycarp. We know that Polycarp was faithful to Church of God teachings. We know that Melito was considered to be faithful. The Church of Rome said he was faithful. Melito listed the books. He listed the 39 books. He didn't list the extra books, the Apocrypha, that the Catholics now use. We know that the Catholic saint and doctor of their church, Jerome, said these books we shouldn't use. They did it anyway. In the continuing Church of God, we accept all the 39 books, but we don't accept the additional ones. Why? Because they're not scriptural. Why? Jesus didn't believe them. Why? Our last scripture, I'd like to go to the book of Jude. Jude's only got one chapter, and I've read this scripture frequently. So apparently there was some trouble in the time of Jude, and he wrote verse 3. I found it necessary to write to you, exhorting you, in order you to do what? To contend earnestly for the faith which was once for all delivered to the saints. Let's think about this. If the saints received the Hebrew Bible in Palestine, 39 books of the Old Testament, that was the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints, at least from the Old Testament perspective. And the people should be contending earnestly for the faith once for all delivered to the saints. And that's what we in the continuing Church of God are doing. It's one of the reasons why I want to go through this, so you understand that what we are using is the Bible, it is the Old Testament, it's the complete Old Testament. We don't rely on any other Old Testament books as being scriptural. Now, some will say, well, Continuing Church of God is a relatively new organization, blah, 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 blah. I would suggest if you want more information on the history of the church, we've got a couple of booklets you can take a look at. One is, True Christian Church Today? And the other is the Continuing History of the Church of God, to explain throughout history what happens to the Church of God. But to this date, we in the Continuing Church of God are faithful to those books of the Bible and the Old Testament. We teach those 39 books are the correct books and the only books of the Old Testament. History supports this. Jesus supports this. The apostles supported this. Early Christians support this. And even Catholic writings and sources support it, even though they changed their mind centuries later. So who's contending for the faith once for all delivered to the saints? We in the Continuing Church of God. This is Dr. Bob Teal for the Continuing Church of God.